this center. So at this point, I'd like to call Morten Lykke Poulsen. I hope I pronounced your name well, Global Innovation Manager, GIA Process Engineering. And he's going to talk about the new production processes to widen the range of dairy ingredients. Now, why this? Well, because the dairy market is not only represented by milk, cheese, and powders and butter. We also have a number of other ingredients, and perhaps who will tell us about the new products. I ask you a question already. There are countries like Ireland, which has focused its attention on ingredients. Okay, you have the floor, Morten.
Good morning, buongiorno. As innovation manager for a supplier of equipment and solution, I have the privilege to work with and push a broad range of technologies into new innovations and new products. And since dairy is a core segment for GEA, I'm in particular happy and pleased to be here today to talk about new developments for dairy ingredients. When I use the wording pushing technologies, it's actually to some degree misleading, because our innovation in most cases begins with an opportunity raised by our customers. We use this list to stimulate, to find new opportunities for our innovation and also to categorize our innovation. To give you an example for dairy and better use of raw materials, I would like to mention whey. Not so many years ago, whey was considered solely as a byproduct and a waste from the cheese production. It was used, if not dumped, it was mainly used for feeding pigs. Today, whey is undergoing a complicated process, including separation and purifications to create new and valuable ingredients. But since I only have 15 minutes here today, and I think time is already flying, today I will only be dealing and discussing innovations within the category product quality, dealing with taste and flavor, and also a way to change functionality to create a new product. The technology implication I will be touching upon is re-engineering in terms of simplification, but also to use an existing technology in a new application, so-called application-driven innovation. As mentioned in my introduction, dairy is a core segment to GEA, where we want to invest in innovation. Looking at demographic trends, such as middle class, or more consumers are moving to the middle class, population is growing, people are moving to the cities, are also supporting that the dairy segment in the future will be investing and installing new process lines. And also within EU, or the EU Commission has also discovered this. So they have now allowed the farmers to produce more milk. In fact, EU now predicts that in the coming 10 years, 14 more million tons of milk will actually be added within Europe. In spite of this promising development, the prices this year in the EU has dropped dramatically. One of the effects to this is of course that Russia has made its embargo, and that has prevented some export from EU to Russia. But perhaps even more importantly is probably that the import China is placing today has been lowered due to an overstocking which took place in 2014. In the future, although this is a good and positive market, the road will be bumpy, and I believe that the answer to this will be product differentiation and innovation to suppress the risk of price pressure, but also commoditization of some of your products. To give you some idea where will the extra volume of milk be placed, as you can see, a lot of the new production will take place in cheese. But also, and another trend you also can see from this plot is that most of the new milk production is expected to be located for export. Again, if you look at it from the dairy ingredient side, we have cheese, we have butter and powder, and where powder includes the bulk production of skim milk powder and whole milk powder, but powder also includes the streams coming from whey. And liquid, what about liquid? In fact, the export of liquid worldwide has during the last 7 years increased by 136%, and EU counts for 40% of this export, and it represents a value of 0.5 billion euro. That's why in the rest of this presentation, I will be discussing two innovations, one innovation for powder, but also one for liquid, to create a concentrate for export. IceCon, the liquid process I will be discussing first, is a quality-driven process. It is a concentration process where concentration is done by removal of ice crystals, and the value-adding aspect is caused by the fact that the liquid is not affected by the concentration step due to the low temperatures. The concentration begins with the crystallization step. The water-containing solution is added, and by refrigeration, spherical ice crystals are formed. The solution with ice crystals are now ready for separation. And the separation takes place in the second unit, the wash column. The wash column functions as a filtration unit, separating the solid ice crystals from the liquid concentrates, and by gravity, the ice crystals will move to the top of the wash column. The water or the ice crystals are melted and leaves the unit as pure water. A small fraction of the water, you do not see it on this sketch here, is used to wash the ice crystals. In the bottom of the column, the concentrated product is leaving the process, and to control the concentration, a recycle is established. You see that as stream number 6, to control the concentration, or the final concentration of the product. This graph shows a GC plot for fresh milk, each component represent a component inside the milk, or within the milk, also including the components that are responsible for the flavor and taste. If you expose the fresh milk to a treatment in a traditional evaporator, you will notice that several of the peaks have disappeared. This heat treatment is causing the loss or the detectable loss of flavor and quality. If you did a similar examination, now exposing the fresh milk to the IceCon unit, you can see that the GC plot is identical to the fresh milk plot. In other words, IceCon is preserving the quality, the full retention of the aromas results in better taste and freshness of the product, and also you eliminate thermal degradation and risk of denaturation of proteins. Freeze concentration is not a new technology. It's a mature technology. But due to its cost structure, it has never penetrated into the dairy market. It has been used in some special niche applications, primarily within coffee and some specialty within juice, fruit juice production. A major re-engineering, including the simplification I mentioned before, has resulted in that the IceCon system we are now capable of offering has a much more attractive CAPEX and OPEX profile. And this has resulted in that we now have a total cost of ownership situation that brings the technology much closer to evaporation. And this cost reduction opens new door for applications in many more fields that we have not seen in the past. On this slide here, you see an image of the new IceCon system, and you see the two key components, the crystallizer and the wash column. There are many opportunities for IceCon, but today I will only exploring opportunities for dairy. The first application for IceCon in dairy is to use the concentrate as an ingredient in industrial food. You see some example here. We have been testing milk chocolate, sour cream, cream cheese, frozen desserts, and ice cream. One of the driver for using ice, for instance, a skim milk concentrate in as a food additive, is to create a product with low-fat product where you still have a rich taste. Another application for IceCon is the consumer beverages. Using the liquid concentrate, reconstitute it, and be able to sell it as a fresh milk product. Alternatively, you can pack the concentrate and sell it to the consumers directly. The third area, we mentioned that as others, includes, for instance, the ability or the possibility to take the liquid concentrate and expose it to a further treatment, for instance, in a spray dryer, creating a high-quality milk powder. This milk powder, again, can be serving application as within industrial food, as an additive in industrial food ingredients. Others also include concentration within the waste stream. And finally, we have also seen the possibility to use ICECON within cheese, production. This is an example how ICECON can be integrated into a more complete process line. And the final, well, the final, it was used as the final concentration step, reaching a concentration of typically 34%. We are quite optimistic about ICECON in dairy, and we have also obtained an industrial reference now in Asia. And part of the customer iteration, he looked at energy cost, but also cleaning cost. ICECON operates at very low temperature, so the risk of creating a biofilm, which you have in the evaporator case, is much less, and that of course results in a much gentler cleaning of the system, also higher uptime and more production. And still, the customer also have of course the advantage of a much better quality. The second process I would like to discuss is the powder process, the MSD granulator. It's part of a spray drying process, and the MSD granulator includes agglomeration and granulation. To understand the MSD granulator, I first would like to discuss briefly the multi-stage driver, the MSD. When the MSD process was introduced to the dairy market more than 30 years ago, it became a revolution to the dairy industry. Today it is the working horse for production of milk powder and for infant formula due to its agglomeration properties. You are able to create a non-dusty, free-flowing powder with improved solubility. The process of MSD, the first stage of drying, begins with a feed introduced at the top of the dryer. Droplets are formed, and the first primary particles are being created. This first part, or first drying, does not include the agglomeration. The agglomeration is obtained by returning fines collected in the source gas system, that could be a black filter as you see here, into the bottom of the drying chamber where a fluid bed is located. The fines and the primary particles are glued together, creating an open structure that is responsible for the good solubility. This structure you can ascribe, or you can compare it with a curly flower like structure. In order to be able to make this agglomeration, you need to operate the fluid bed at a quite high humidity. You need the products to be fairly sticky in order to make the agglomeration. This is the reason, also the reason why when you assess the gas leaving the chamber, it has a fairly high humidity, and is actually inside the stickiness curve represented by the green dot. The primary particle formation is outside the stickiness curve. You're not allowed to work inside the stickiness curve due to the risk of deposits. So properly speaking, you can say that the MSD concept allows you to operate critical inside the stickiness curve. And this lower temperature level also helps you in terms of energy efficiency compared to a traditional one-stage spray dryer. The energy efficiency is increased by 5 to 10% by changing from a conventional spray dryer to a multi-stage spray dryer. The MSD granulator is an evolution of the MSD process. The feed is being added to the fluid bed at the bottom of the chamber. It's being sprayed into it. And this process creates larger and stronger particles with a higher mechanical integrity, less prone to disintegrate in the powder handling and packaging that takes place after the spray dryer. As for the ICECON, the MSD granulator concept also has a lot of application and possibilities. We see possibilities within agrochemicals, vitamins, food, and dairy, of course. In dairy, it's a way to create a stronger bulk skim milk powder, but it also opens the door for creating a powder with two different feed compositions. So adding a new feed composition to the fluid bed will enable you to create new functionality of the powder. This comparison here has been made to compare spray dryer, traditional spray dryer, the MSD, and the MSD granulator. And as you can see, if you compare the MSD granulator against the traditional MSD, it's first of all larger particles, elimination of dust, and the possibility of combining two different ingredients. That's the major advantages of using the MSD granulator. And if we look at the particle size distribution comparison here, the green curve is the MSD curve, and after adding the granulator for the same product and same application, we were able to move to the blue curve, and as you can see, the average particle size increased from close to 100 to 150. But actually, it is possible, if you change conditions further, to obtain with the MSD granulator a particle size close to 500 microns. This was my final slide. If you have any questions, please feel free.
Grazie.
Thank you very much, Mr. Paulsen. And there is a question. Could you please get your headphones?
What do you think about the super milk by Coca-Cola?
I think it's of course interesting to see that there is perhaps a change in a very firm structure in the dairy industry that we now see. Beverages companies are now also moving into dairy, and I think if we look into the future, we're probably going to see also a much more flexible and versatile production also inside the dairy. I mean, if Coca-Cola now starts to move into dairy, I guess dairy also needs to move into Coca-Cola's territory, right?
Siete presenti in Asia.
You are present in Asia. Which is the type of reaction you've seen in those markets?
You have a plan? Grazie. Ah, ripeto io la domanda, va bene. You have a plant in Asia with GEA. Mm-hmm. What's the response of the market, the Asian market?
The response, I mean, we have, of course, a lot of plants in Asia. And in terms, if your question relates to in terms of innovation, we actually also in Asia see innovation that that have been developed in Asia. So we actually see, for instance, in China, new process development, also supporting development of new ingredients that actually are coming from China and are not being first developed in Europe and then transferred to China. So we see now also that innovation starts to take place in the local market. And that's, of course, a new challenge also to GEA, because then we need to listen even more to our customer also in China and in Asia.
Okay. Thank you. Ci sono domande? Mr. Sodi.
Any questions? Mr. Sodi?
The new technology on ICECON freeze concentration process is really very relevant for the areas where milk needs to be transported longer distances, or where milk needs to be produced in one season then to be used next season. But I'd like to ask you one question, that compared to drying or RO process, what is the difference in capital cost and operational cost? Because you want to save in transportation cost if processing cost is lower than the transportation cost.
You're referring to ICECON?
Yeah.
And it's a very good question. We probably see at the time being more possibility as a liquid concentrate. And the reason for that, I maybe hide a little bit, is due to the fact that with ICECON you are not capable of obtaining the same concentration as you are capable of achieving in an evaporator. So if you're doing a spray drying process, you are able to run only with an inlet concentration of 32% or 34%. If you use an evaporator for the same skim milk product, the inlet concentration may be up to close to 50%. So you're not running the spray driver in an economical way. I think it requires a more evaluation to say, and also depending on the transport you are seeing, whether it makes sense to convert fully into powder or just stop with the concentrate and export the concentrate.
But can this technology can be commercialized?
One more time.
This technology, can it be commercialized?
Yes. And we have seen now that there is a customer in Asia who is using it in an industrial unit. So that's why we are quite optimistic about it.
Thank you.
Ci sono altre domande?
Any other questions? Yes, there is one more question. Please introduce yourself.
Italia. I see that in your process you use first a reverse osmosis and then your system. Isn't it possible to reach the same concentration only with a reverse osmosis?
No. I mean, the concentration you can reach by filtration is lower than with the freeze concentration.
Thanks. What is the grade of concentration that you can reach first with the reverse osmosis and then with your process in terms of percentage of dry matter?
I think the example we showed with skim milk, the reverse osmosis concentration was about 17%. So the ice concentration was taking the 70% up to 34%.
Thank you.
Grazie. Thank you, Mr. Paulsen. Io darei la parola a